This is Janice Sullivan from Sullivan J Photography. Today I'm going to talk to you about processing your stacked images using Helicon Focus. So what is a stacked image? Let me show you. I'm actually on my website here. Let's scroll down and show you this image. When you photograph up close, you'll lose depth of field, which means they'll be less in focus in your camera. You can use an f-stop that's high, but truthfully, Helicon Focus is so cool to use and easy to use that it's better for you to go ahead and stack your images. And what I mean is, when you take the picture, you're going to focus on an area and make sure that it is in focus, and then you're going to slowly keep taking pictures, overlapping everything that is sharp in your camera. And then once you have what you want, you can merge them all together into one photograph, so everything that you wanted in focus is sharp and eye-drawing to the viewer. For example, this image, I couldn't get all of this leaf in focus and the leaf down here in focus. So I had to stack my photographs, take a picture, 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 and take a picture, and then merge all of the photographs so everything is in focus. Once you get that down, you can even have fun, like I did on this image up here. Now in this image, I focused only on the stem, and up close you really can see that this is all in focus. But it was too distracting to have the petals in focus, so I made sure that those were actually out of focus, and I'll show you how to do that in Helicon Focus. Let's go ahead and start the way I process my images, and then of course I'll give you other tips along the way in case you want to do things differently. I process my photographs here in Lightroom. You can take your image files and load them into Helicon Focus. For me, I like to actually play a little bit with the photograph because you have more power here with the raw image. What I like to do is always categorize my stacked photographs because it becomes a blur. And as you can see here to the left, it has 156 photographs just in this file. So it's just easy for me to just throw them in red. That's how I end up putting my categories, is that they're red, and then when I'm actually working on them, I'll give them a couple stars so they're all the same. Pulls up into my library, and everything is highlighted at the bottom left, you can see. And then I'll go straight into the development module. Click up there. Now at the bottom left, you can see this guy is the one that's actually being worked on. It's the brightest of them all. And I'll usually start through the camera calibration because you can really change up a lot of your colors here. It's RGB, and that is every color in the spectrum that we can see, so you really can play with this area. I'm going to actually go to neutral. We're going to do this quickly because it's a video tutorial and we want to get through it fast, so I'm just going to show you really quick. I'll go to lens corrections, play with that. I'll do some basics. I might even go into here a little bit, but we'll go ahead. I know this looks kind of cool in tungsten. And if I do an auto, I think it gets too bright. Yes, it is a little bright, so it'll bring down the exposure just a little bit. Then, once I'm done with all of the goodies that I've played with in the development area, I will go to the bottom right here, and I will sync up these bottom photographs with the image that I was just playing with. I'll go ahead and synchronize that right now. And the next thing is to go into Helicon Focus, and that's super easy. Everything's highlighted. You just do a right click, go to export, and then up to Helicon Focus and click on that. And while that's going through, I'll give you a couple tips. make sure all your exposures are the same. The program can't handle if one section is super bright and the same section is dark. It will give you a hard time. So make sure exposures is correct and all of your changes are all similar. And when you're photographing, manually change your focus. You can do that either with your lens or you can use a focus rack. And I'll give you a link to that also, because when I do these tutorials, I always like to give you all the goodies that you can use to enjoy your experience. See how this is paused right here? That's just saying that you're still working on this image because it has opened Helicon. We will go to that right now. And once you're done with all the changes and you push apply, it brings back the information into Lightroom so you have that TIFF file that you've just completed. Let's get on to the next video so you can learn the interface of Helicon Focus. This is where I'm going to show you all the different areas to play with to make your images really pop. In the first video tutorial, I discussed preparing your images for Helicon Focus. Now we're going to discuss the interface of the software. So let's get to it. This is the interface of Helicon Focus. And with anything new, you really should take the time and get acclimated in the various areas of the software. It just helps you become a better photographer. This way you understand the different things that the software can do for you. And that's what this short tutorial is about. We're going to go over a couple things that are basic. This way when we get into the last video and we're processing, you're not going to say to yourself, "Where was that? Where did she go? I don't understand." Take the time and pay attention to everything that I'm showing you, and it will help you figure out what you need to do in your various circumstances. Up at the top left is your menu. You can get into your preferences here and do some adjustments in this area. You can actually load files here, open images. Like I said, there are several ways that you can open your images in Helicon Focus. This is one of them. And if I want to start a new stack, because anytime you open images, it will remove all of the images that you brought in originally. So if I pick these photographs here and then did a shift and then went to open, it will go ahead and add them to Helicon, but it will remove the source images that I just sent over from Lightroom. So we'll just cancel out of that for now. I like these over here. The toolbar is just easy access. Again, you can open images this way. And we'll use these two when we actually render, which means that we're going to merge all the photographs together. This right here with the little camera is called Helicon Remote. And let me just show this to you briefly. Helicon Remote is a tool that's an extra, so you would have to pay for this. But what's nice about it is if you want to do time lapse, you can do this. You connect your computer to your camera. It's kind of like tethering in Lightroom, where you connect your computer and your camera and you can visually see what you're photographing. What's nice about this is that you can actually take a photograph of the foreground, the very front, and then take a photograph towards the very back, which is in focus. It will take all of the rest of the images that are needed to have a complete in focus photograph. Just to let you know that this program here has a really hard time with moving subjects. So really, if you're going to do this, it should really be in a studio environment. All right, let's get out of this so we can get back into the Helicon Focus. The render button up at the top here on the left, the green render button is here also. And that basically means when you push this button, it will take all of the source images to the right and combine them. And we will do that in the next video. Again, here at the top, there is a rendering button, a retouching button. There's a text and scale. You can actually add text to your images, and the saving button. Over here to the right is the source images that we want to use to combine to make one focused image. Then we get down here to the bottom, very little small area in here, and I think this is important. If you click on this little dial here, you can open your images here, remove images, and or remove all of your images. There's a lot of goodies in here that you can play with, so that's there for you if needed. We'll get into the radius and smoothing when we actually process a photograph. Same with the outputs here. We'll talk a little bit about that when we're processing the images. Down below is super important. This is where you really need to pay attention to getting up close. If I want to go one-to-one, I click on this bottom area right here and boom, you're automatically one-to-one. I push my space bar, it gives me the little hand guy here, and you can move the image around to see what you want to see. And you really do need to get up close because you'll be surprised, especially if you have a lot of images stacking, you'll need to see what's going on and what's in focus. If you want to get closer, you just pretty much can move this guy, or you can push the plus sign if you like. We're at 200% now. If you want to get back to view everything, just go ahead and click on this guy right here at the bottom. So these are really cool tools to see. Oh, I want to show you this too. I kind of feel that Helicon really needs to improve on this, truthfully, because this kind of is just so small for me. But this little thing right here is a magnifying glass, and that's kind of showing us where we're at. If you want to view the various areas, you can just hold this down and move it around. Now let's get on to the fun part where we're actually processing the image, and I'm going to show you some retouching and some fun goodies while you're actually in Helicon Focus to make your images the way you want them to be. Now we're getting into the fun stuff. So let's get started. So what do I mean about the fun stuff? The fun stuff is merging all of your photographs together to see what it looks like after you have rendered it. It's so cool to see the outputs of what this software does for you. On the right, you can see that I have all my source images checked. If for some reason you don't want a certain image to be part of the rendering, you can just uncheck it. What is important is the rendering methods. There are three methods in this program that are important. And what I'm going to do now is I have made sure that all of the images are checked, and I'll start rendering these methods and talk about the information why they're rendering, and then we'll take a good look at all three of them. Method A is checked. I'll leave the radius and smoothing at its defaults, and we will talk about that in a little bit. And I'll push this render button. What method A does is it works on the contrast of the subject. So it takes the different contrast and calculates that to sharpen your image. Method B, we'll click on that now, and I will leave the radius and smoothing the same here also. Method B basically works with your images when you have consecutively shot in order, say from the front to the back or from the back to the front. This is a great program to use when you have taken the time to consecutively shoot your images. A and B both have the radius and the smoothing slider. Radius is important because it brings out those fine details of your image. So if you have fine hair or really detailed information, make sure your radius is low. Actually, the software suggests 3 to 5. If you want to change the radius, you can use this here by moving the slider, or you can actually use the arrow keys down in here and change the radius that way. Again, the radius is really important for those fine details, but what happens is you'll get more halos and noise problems when you use the lower number. So if you start getting that, then bring your radius up to a higher number. By bringing your smoothing down, that also produces sharper images, and you can adjust them here or here. Each time you make an adjustment here, you have to render it again. If you've noticed, the first one is telling me that I used A, method A, and this is my radius, and this is my smoothing. And this is what I really like about the output, is that you can do a variety of calculations and then just go back and forth to see which is the best for you. The last method is the pyramid. This method is good for complex images. If you have, say, 100 stacks of images that you want to merge together, definitely use the pyramid. But you do have to be careful with your contrast and glare in the image. So you may have to change your contrast, say in Lightroom or another program that you use, if you feel like it's just overdoing the contrast of your output image. After you played with all of your outputs and the various ways that you can make your image sharper, I suggest that you actually view them up close. A good start is just to evaluate each image that you have sent to the output folder down here below. We'll go into the retouching real quick, because if you do have problems, this is where you can fix it, or if you want to do an artistic approach to your image, you can play with it there. Click up at the top in the retouching area. Once you're in the retouching area, you can use these tools up here in the top right. We're in this brush right here. These are the two brushes that I use, the brush that we're in now and the eraser. These source images, let's get up close so you can kind of see what I'm talking about. These source images each have different areas that are in focus, and as you click on them, you can see the variety of focused areas. I'm noticing down here at the bottom that it didn't do a very good job cleaning this up. So I'm going to go ahead and paint to make sure that all of my water drops are in focus. Remember in the beginning I told you can be artistic. If you'd like to use an area that's actually out of focus just for your own creative perspective, pick something that you want to play with. And then you could paint that in your output image below. If you decide that this isn't a good feel for you, you can go to the top right and click on the eraser brush and then just paint that out. And basically, once you get everything fixed the way you would like this output to look like, then you go ahead and get into the saving area up here at the top. Once you've gone through all of the images and you're happy with everything, all you have to do next is go to this saving tab. Click on that. Click on the saving area here. Title your new image and click save, and it will add a new TIFF file to the files that you were working on, and Lightroom will have all that information for you so you can go on and play with the photograph even more. Let's go ahead and now look at the completed image.